Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. We're excited about our program today. We have a special guest. In addition to our usual panel, I am Fred Levering. We have Martha Richardson with us.
Hi.
And Tom Gallagher.
Hello.
Coming in from way over there. We have John Forrester.
Hello, everyone.
Ruth Martelli.
Hi.
And Fred Opalinski.
Hey, good to be with you.
And the new addition is Lauren Hammond. Lauren is with the Berks County Intermediate Unit. A couple weeks ago, we got into a conversation about kids that are temporarily moving around a bit, we'll say. She's going to give us the proper definitions in schools, in our public schools. This is public, not any private schools or whatever, but public schools. And we wanted to discuss the situation. This was prompted by an article that I saw in the Reading Eagle that talked about the Reading Senior High School, the Reading School District, but at the Senior High School, building a facility for these kids to be able to gather themselves and perhaps take a shower or whatever and before they enter into the school day. And that got us talking about whether it is a phenomenon that exists outside of the city, and Martha did some of her usual research for us, came up with a state website that indicated that as of, this was the 21-22, I think, school year, if I'm correct, Martha. 2021. There were 1,550 some kids that fell into this situation in Berks County. About half of them were in Reading, but that means the other half were all scattered about. And this is not a well-known situation. So after Martha bringing it to our attention and us getting some really rudimentary information, we decided that it would be worthwhile to welcome somebody that actually knows what they're talking about.
And hence, supposed to Martha who doesn't.
You said that, I didn't.
I'm just implying.
That brings us to Lauren. So Lauren, the podium is yours.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to be on the show and to help bring awareness to the issue of youth homelessness in our community of Berks County. I am the training and projects coordinator for Region 2 of the Education for Children and Youth Experiencing Homelessness Program, or ECHEA for short. And ECHEA is an initiative of the Pennsylvania Department of Education and includes 8 regional offices across the state. So my office covers Region 2, and we're administered by the Berks County Intermediate Unit. And we also work with all of the public school districts across Berks County, as well as Chester, Lancaster, Lebanon, Dauphin, Schuylkill counties as well. So we work with about 95 school districts. And we are largely responsible for providing training and technical assistance to each of those school districts regarding the McKinney-Vento Homeless Assistance Act, which is the federal education law that provides protections for students experiencing homelessness. This law also requires every public school district to designate somebody as a homeless liaison or McKinney-Vento liaison, and they are ultimately responsible for facilitating the process, the identification and support of those students sort of on the ground and providing that direct service to students. And we work with the homeless liaisons to help them come up with processes for identification in their district and ultimately help to eliminate educational barriers for students experiencing homelessness. So during the 2021-2022 school year, which is the most recent year we are able to share data from publicly, we identified over 40,000 students across the state of Pennsylvania, and 2,488 of those were identified right here in Berks County. So this really is a widespread issue that we're seeing, you know, across the state in Berks County. And while, you know, as you've mentioned, there is a large pocket of those individuals identified in Redding, we are seeing this in every school district across Berks County.
So now the numbers you cited, would you guess, or I'm sure it'd be much more than a guess for you, that since the pandemic has gone on the wane, that those numbers would be lower?
Yeah, it's really interesting to see the data over the course of the pandemic. We saw a decline in the numbers of identification during that year of COVID. So the 2020-2021 school year, we identified 30,666, or I should have written that number down. It was lower than the 40,003. And we attribute that largely to the challenges of identifying students when you're lacking that face-to-face interaction with them. So, you know, we task our school districts with picking up on red flags of homelessness and identifying when students are in a displaced situation. And a lot of those red flags come about with developing relationships with students and, you know, seeing the clothing that they come to school wearing, or, you know, the lack of school supplies. So COVID made it really challenging. And additionally, with the increase in virtual learning, students were really able to participate in their school from wherever they happened to be staying, even if they were bouncing around from place to place. So the following year, we did see quite an increase in identification after COVID, whether that's, you know, because there was an increase of homelessness. There also have been additional initiatives to help increase the identification in general, additional outreach and education to our districts and the community. So there are a variety of factors why we think that number has since increased.
Laura, how do the kids come into your purview of care? Is it automatic just because somebody identifies them as being without a regular home, or do they need to reach out to you and say, we'd like help? Or, I mean, how does the system work?
So students are identified in a variety of ways. Every school district handles it a little bit differently. Many of them will have screening questions at the time of enrollment that would flag a family that may be living somewhere that is unstable. Other times, families hear of our program and they'll reach out to us directly, and then we sort of act as a liaison to the district to help get them connected. Our program sometimes will work directly with families, but it's largely up to the school districts to make that identification, particularly the homeless liaisons.
Could you tell us exactly what the definition is for a homeless student?
What's a typical case?
I mean, certainly. What's the legal definition that Pennsylvania uses? I know it's pretty specific.
Yes, absolutely. So under the McKinney-Vento Act, the law defines homelessness as lacking a fixed, regular, or adequate nighttime residence due to some sort of precipitating event. And that's, when we're talking about that, that's family homelessness, students that are experiencing homelessness with their families. In addition to that, we also have a separate category called unaccompanied homeless youth. And those individuals are lacking that fixed, regular, and adequate nighttime residence for any reason, and are also not in the physical custody of a legal parent or guardian. So a fixed regular or lacking a fixed regular and adequate nighttime residence can look a variety of ways. If they're living somewhere that's unsheltered or in some sort of substandard housing, like a car or a tent, or maybe even a condemned home. We also have individuals living in shelters or other transitional housing programs, those living in hotels or motels, and particularly those who are doubled up. And this is broadly defined as sharing the housing of others due to the loss of their own housing or economic hardship. And the majority of families identified as McKinney-Vento eligible fall under this doubled up category. So for example, if we have a family that has lost their home in a fire and is now staying temporarily with a grandparent until they can get a new place of their own, that family is going to qualify as doubled up. So,
if a child is living with grandparents and the grandparents don't have custody, is that child considered also homeless?
Potentially, yes. We have to look at every case individually at a variety of factors, but if the grandparents don't have custody of that student, it's likely going to be considered an unaccompanied homeless youth case.
Can you give us an example of what's the typical case? I mean, what's the average or mean case that you see? What would be the iconic case?
We experience a lot of issues related to job loss and loss of income leading to eviction. And the majority of our families, between 61 and 66% of families fall under the doubled up category. So we have a family that has been evicted for whatever reason. During COVID, we had a lot of individuals losing their jobs and then are unable to secure permanent housing right away. So then they maybe stay with a family friend or, a grandparent for a while until they can get back up on their feet. And the reason, there's a lot of reasons why families may end up in doubled up situations. We are fortunate to have a variety of shelters, especially in Berks County, but all shelters have capacity limits and eligibility requirements. And so it can be difficult to access those resources. So many times doubling up is really the family's only option.
Now, when you
identify. What's the age span of the kids that you deal with in Berks County?
That's a great question. So the law does not specifically define an age limit. So we can identify students, from birth all the way up to the age of 22 in Pennsylvania based on the special education law. So if the student is still eligible to be educated in the public school system, they could potentially still qualify if they meet the definition of homelessness under the act.
Now, Lauren, would you say that you mostly look at this as dealing with families or with minors?
The majority of students that are identified are experiencing homelessness with their families. About 11% of students are identified as an unaccompanied youth.
And so is your approach working in concert with other programs working to help families that are experiencing homelessness?
Largely, yes.
Okay. But But because they have a school-age student, does that mean that you have shelter options for them that they might not otherwise have?
Our program does not specifically provide housing services, but what we can do is help to connect families to those existing community resources and make those referrals.
Okay. Now, one of the other things, and this is going to sound really bland, but I just know it's such a common thing, is that, these families experience homelessness and they double up with somebody. It's often very likely it's not the same school district. How does that affect things?
That's great. And that leads me to, the rights under McKinney-Vento. So arguably one of the most important rights that students have is the right to remain in their school of origin if they're identified. So for example, taking Berks County school districts in this example, if we have a student that is permanently housed and attending Wilson School District and their family experiences a fire and now they're doubled up in Wyomissing School District, the student has the right to attend either, but we're going to assume it's in their best interest to stay with Wilson because that's their original school. And generally, staying in that same school is going to create the fewest barriers educationally for that student. So we ultimately look at a variety of best interest, student-centric factors, and take their wishes into priority when it comes to determining where that student should enroll in school.
Now, this goes back to 1987. How has the program evolved in those numerous years? I know for everybody on this panel, it seems like yesterday, but for other people, you know, more about your age, probably seems like a really long time ago.
Our program has certainly developed over the years. I can't give you the exact start date of when Pennsylvania put this program into motion, but it has evolved in, you know, the number of staff members we have. Particularly post-COVID, we've been able to expand significantly. So, you know, we have 8 regional offices, each with different staff members. We all kind of operate a little bit differently. And, you know, we're able to provide supports to our school districts on a more in-depth level, I think, than before.
And it's state-funded, but it's federally government-created.
Correct.
Okay.
I'm thinking of a student enrolling in a school, just, you know, parents bring him in, wants to enroll them. The school district normally then requires proof of residency. Mm-hmm. The student who is experiencing homelessness, the family doesn't have to prove that. Is that correct? And to get into the federal lunch program or the federal meals program, normally a family has to provide income information. But again, I understand that students who are in the homeless category, families do not have to provide that. And that, in fact, getting service from your agency or your department is not based on a family's income.
Absolutely.
I think that's important to understand that homelessness does not have an income limit after which services are no longer provided.
Lauren, can you give us an idea of the sorts of services that you provide? You said you don't really, for example, find housing for someone who doesn't have a place to stay. What kinds of support do you offer? Is it only through the school districts, or do you have direct a direct relationship to provide support?
Our program operates by supporting the school districts mainly. So families will mainly get their direct support from the school district liaisons, and we will often work with liaisons on particular cases to help meet, you know, extra needs that the family might have. We have the ability to support school districts in providing educational resources, including school supplies. We currently are offering something called Project Connect, which is supplying free educational kits, as well as hygiene kits, school supply kits, feminine hygiene kits, and winter care kits to any individual that is identified as McKinney-Vento eligible in our region. So simply the liaisons or individual from the school district would request that, and then we can send that on their way to send to the student. So we don't have a lot of direct contact with families, but we can support our school districts in that way.
And how many liaisons are there in each school district?
Every school district must have one. And some school districts have opted to develop a program that has building level liaisons. So in the Reading School District, for example, they are fortunate to have social workers in every building. And so those individuals are also trained on how to identify and support. But some districts just have one individual in this role.
Now, Lauren,
I'm gonna ask a question that's
going
to be controversial, but I'm sorry. Could you give us some ethnic background? I know Fred and I had an online discussion about the city of Reading. Are most of those that fall into the students who fall into the homelessness category Hispanic? Are they single parent families? Could you give us a little bit of demographics of them?
No, I can't give specific data on that, as the Department of Education doesn't collect that data specifically, but I can tell you sort of informally that, you know, other sources of data have pointed to discrepancies racially. And, you know, we do see a larger percentage of individuals living in poverty in Reading in particular that are minorities. And so this is certainly an issue that affects the population differently. In addition to that, it also disproportionately affects individuals among the LGBTQ community. But that data is not necessarily supported by PDE, just there are other sources of data that have done reports on that.
Thank you. Lauren, is the fact that it's the gay community, if you will, for shorthand, is that because those kids have been excluded from the family home?
In many cases, yes.
But one of the things I wanted to go back to that you had said before, and I'm not so sure everybody has digested this, is that 89% of the cases you're dealing with are traditional homelessness situations. It's families that have lost their homes and they have school-aged children. So these things that you're dealing with on a daily basis are actually mirroring to a large extent what's happening with homelessness around the country in any place. So I think that's really interesting that we're not talking about necessarily a large number of these where there is a divide between the kids and the family. 90%, 89% of them are about a family and they're what you guys can do to help them with their school-aged child. Is that fair?
Certainly.
Yeah, okay. So then are you seeing a lot of this mirroring homeless trends in the U.S., meaning that the percentage of homelessness is going down? Are we winning this fight, or is that something you're not necessarily seeing?
You know, I'm not sure. We're seeing our numbers increase, and I'm not sure if that's truly because homelessness is increasing or if we're just getting better at identifying it. Mm-hmm. You know, some of us believe that the homelessness has been there, you know, we're just equipped with more information and, you know, able to advocate and provide families with information. And so I think we're just getting better at identifying.
Now, back early in the session here, Lauren, you indicated that 60-some percent are doubled up. Mm-hmm. Where are the other 40%?
So approximately 25-27% are in shelters or some sort of transitional housing. About 9 or 10% are in hotels or motels. And just a few percent, 2 or 3, are in the unsheltered or substandard housing category.
Thanks. What would you say is your hope for the future? Where do you know, you want to see everybody in a stable home and all that, but that's unlikely. So what is your dream for the future?
Well, you know, bringing more awareness to this issue is so important. The word homeless carries such a stigma, and families are often ashamed and embarrassed to come forward with this information. And so, you know, I really try to get this information out and hope that families feel more comfortable sharing this information with their school district, because we ultimately want to do everything that we can to help. You know, unfortunately, there's not much on our end to be done with the housing crisis, but you know, I hope that we can help to sort of eliminate the stigma around the issue.
I think the vast improvement has come about since this McKinney-Vento bill. I can tell you that in my teaching at Muhlenberg, before there was identification, we had homeless students that we made accommodations for, probably illegally, I'm sure illegally. So I'm retired now. I can say that, yes, we allowed kids to sleep in the locker room. Yes, we allowed kids to come in early and take showers. and to do their laundry in the trainer's room so that they could have clean laundry. We have always had these students. We at least now have a way of being able to identify them openly and helping them openly instead of trying to give them other under the cover help. And when I taught at Albright, I had a homeless student. When the dorms were closed, he lived in his car. So that our universities have homeless students as well.
I'll bet you private schools have them too. I mean, we excluded them because they're not part of the public school system, but there's no reason to believe that somebody who goes to a private school is immune from all of these factors that render somebody without a permanent home.
Right.
In your view, Lauren, how do you evaluate the Knight's Keep, which is what's being built now at Reading High, to offer facilities for cleanliness, hygiene, whatever, to kids? I mean, is that, because you know in the community there are going to be people who will talk about wasting money on, you know, there still is a lot of prejudice that surrounds the economic factors of making you homeless. But in your professional opinion, what do you say about the Knight's Keep?
I am incredibly excited about this project, and I'm so happy that Reading School District is able to offer this to all of their students. I think it's incredibly needed. I wish every school district could provide that for their students. And, you know, prejudice aside, we're talking about kids. Kids who are innocent and need and deserve our support. And, you know, regardless of others' beliefs, you know, I just strongly believe that if we have the power to support our children in need, we should.
Well, and that's why I asked the question initially about how these students are identified, because I could imagine areas, school districts, that don't want to admit the problem, and therefore they're not going to identify or connect with you. Now, I'm hoping that I'm just being cynical and that that's not the case, but I mean, what's your experience? Do you have not to identify them, but are there school districts in the county that are less welcoming to the support you want to offer?
You know, we do everything that we can to advocate for students and share this information. I think our school districts do a great job at identifying and supporting our students.
Okay, so pretty much across the board, you find people open to and receptive to the work that you're doing?
For the most part, absolutely.
Okay, good. I'm glad to hear that.
Now, Lauren, I'm sure you have interaction with colleagues from around the state and so on. How does Berks County compare?
In terms of identification?
Well, numbers, identification, whatever comes to your mind. I mean, I would assume that a place like Philadelphia is going to have much higher numbers, but...
Certainly. Philadelphia's numbers are quite high. You know, Berks County is one of the higher in identification across the counties. You know, that is largely related to population density and the prevalence of those experiencing poverty. So, you know, even if we're talking about Reading versus the rest of Berks County, Reading School District, for example, has roughly, you know, 17,000, 18,000 students, and Muhlenberg has about 4,000. So there's a big difference in the number of those identified, I think largely related to the population. But yes, Philadelphia in particular has a large challenge with students experiencing homelessness.
Cool. Panel, what else do you have? Anything?
Yeah, what kind of liaisons or relationship do you have with non-educational institutions? I'm thinking of community organizations like the Olivets, the YMCA, that kind of thing.
We try to be actively involved with those organizations that serve students experiencing homelessness. I actually chair a committee, the Berks Youth Committee, which is a subcommittee of the Berks Coalition to End Homelessness. So we work to get the school district liaisons and representatives from different community agencies, you know, including all of its, the LGBT center, migrant education, and get them all into a room and just resource share. You know, knowledge is power, and there are many, many resources out in our community, but having that information is what, you know, makes the difference.
Are the folks who are liaisons generally from the administration, or are they teachers, or are they reimbursed for their work, or is this just another thing that gets added to their list of things to do?
Every school district handles it a little bit differently. There are some who are administrators, some serving as superintendents or principals, assistant principals. But a lot of the time, it's a social worker or a guidance counselor in this role. And we generally recommend that, you know, it's a social worker or somebody who can for sure, you know, provide the extent of services that are being required of them. The law is pretty specific in what is required of our public school districts. And it's a large role to fill. I commend all of our homeless liaisons because they have a very tough job.
Okay, I'm coming from the newspaper reporter in me. This is a federally funded program under the Department of Education, I assume?
Yes.
Okay. Is there a financial incentive for a school district to participate? In other words, what's the taxpayers? What's the cost to the taxpayers for this?
I admittedly don't have the answer to that. I will say that this is a federal mandate, so they are legally required to participate in this program. As in terms of the funding, I can't quite speak to that.
I had thought before I'd asked this question, but it probably was misunderstood. I thought it was state funding that it's federal.
I apologize. I think I had misspoken. It does stem from the federal Department of Education, okay. And that filters down to the state departments, and then every state handles it a little bit differently.
So it could be this whole program, which obviously there's a huge need for, could be terminated as with the change of administration.
You're certainly correct.
And this, I would think that one of the big problems, especially for the, and I had some students at Nuremberg who were couch surfers, as they move from, it must be hard keeping track, I guess is what I'm trying to say. It must be very hard keeping track of these students. And I know that, for instance, I had a friend who was a secretary at an elementary school in Reading, and their change in student population was incredible by the end of the year. I mean, about 85% was different than it was in the beginning. And that of course included more than just those who were involved in a homeless situation. But it must be really, really difficult for these, especially for kids who are on their own, who are alone or whatever you call them, independently homeless. Moving from one couch to another must be really difficult. And I, thinking about liaisons, as I said, we didn't have a program like that when I was teaching, but I think our school nurses were the saviors of any student in need. They went to the school nurse, and it was the school nurse then who helped us find under the radar ways of helping them.
When I was pastor at Trinity, we had a relationship with 10th and Penn, and I remember that statistic similarly. It was 80 to 85% of the students changed their address during the course of the year at least once. That was mind-blowing to me, thinking about my elementary school experience, where I don't know of anybody that moved ever. And realizing the importance of stability for the life and well-being of a child, for the ability to be educated. I mean, you need to have that sense of stability. And so the repeated change in one's home environment must just be enormously challenging.
I think that's why for a time there was a real push in the Reading School District to align the curriculum so that if you started at Lowers Park but ended up at 13th in U, the 10th in Penn along the way, the curriculum would be arranged so that you would fit into the curriculum no matter where you landed, when you landed. Because obviously, if you're one of the kids that we're describing, you have hit and miss education at the very best. But in the best possible situation, you have a curriculum that kids can drop into and fit in and not have these enormous gaps in their education. The other, I think another really critical community extension for kids where they can find solace, do their homework, expand their horizons is public libraries. And especially in the city, kids would say, my soul was saved by my local library. Mm-hmm. So people who are looking for places to put money in their mouths, libraries are a great place because they're pretty much drop-in and they have all the kinds of utensils, learning tools that kids need to keep up with the pace. But I think critically important is to get kids to think beyond where they are now. You know, if I taught in the city for a time, I taught in Philadelphia for a time, and I think kids who live in poverty can only think to the extent of their noses because they've got to survive for the next minute, half hour, hour, day, whatever. But somehow for those people like you, Lauren, who work with, and I'm asking a lot of you and you already give a lot, it's having people encourage these kids to see beyond the immediate, to imagining yourself not where you are. How can I get beyond where I am? It's so important for kids not because...
Instilling a sense of hope. Right.
Well, we already among children is rising. And part of the reason is because they are drowning in so much sorrow and pain that hope is like a prescription. And we're all responsible for finding that hope, whether we want to have that obligation or not.
Lauren,
is there a mentor program or anything available for volunteers? I don't know if that's a school, it would be a school district situation but I've been involved in some mentor situations that have been really wonderful, not just for the person I was working for, but for me. And I would, you know, I would love to participate in something if I could be of any help at my age to encourage, to encourage or help. Or I just wondered if there were any BCIU programs for volunteers or also ways to donate. You're talking about feminine hygiene products, huge, huge situation. Is there any way we can contact or anybody we can contact about any of that?
You know, I can't think of any mentorship programs off the top of my head. I'm sure they're out there. So I would encourage viewers to get involved with the community and try to find out where they could support that. Every school district like I've mentioned, has a liaison, so individuals can reach out to that person and see if there may be a mentorship program available in their local school district. And in addition, you know, maybe they have a community care closet that might need donations. A lot of our school districts offer hygiene products and clothing and in some food pantry items as well to students. So, you know, helping to stock those things is always a great way to help.
Well, I just had an answer for John's question about funding, because I took the moment to actually look it up. From 2010 to 2023, the budget for the McKinney-Vento program doubled to $130 million. Now, I want to put that in perspective for folks. Exactly. That's 80 cents per taxpayer if we split it up evenly among the taxpayers. So it is not a hefty budget at all.
No.
But it is one that is getting more attention, because obviously a doubling since 2010 is more than what you would have seen in general currency inflation, et cetera, during that time. So.
And I can add that during the pandemic, we had the American Rescue Plan Act that provided some additional funding. That funding is unfortunately going to be ending soon, so I'm not exactly sure what things will look like in the future, but we were fortunate to have some additional funding, which in our region helped to fund that Project Connect that I was talking about, those STEM kits and things like that. So it's certainly, you know, we're hopeful that we'll have the funding we need to continue our initiatives in the future.
Do the students that you deal with, Lauren, end up with social issues, bullying, or what like that?
I mean, every individual experiences everything differently, but we do see that students experiencing homelessness are at a higher risk of experiencing bullying or experiencing mental health issues. As I believe Ruth had mentioned, you know, a lot of these individuals are living in survival mode, and living in that high level of stress day to day leads to mental health issues, health issues. You know, ending the cycle of homelessness, it can be a challenge for our students. So it's certainly not without its, you know, coexisting issues.
Now, I want to take advantage of Tom being with us. Is this an issue that you hear about in your travels in Europe?
Homelessness, or specifically?
No, specifically the kids. I'm sure there's homelessness. But
it is. I mean, pretty much most of these things, as far as I'm aware, the little bit of exposure I've had, is basically family homelessness. Homelessness in Europe in general, well, it's really hard to say Europe in general, because it's very different experiences in different places, but is pretty pronounced. I mean, you will find sizable ones, but like homelessness in the U.S., people confuse it. I think in the U.S., most people think of unsheltered homelessness as being homelessness. Homelessness in the U.S. actually is the majority of people are sheltered. They're just not in something that they are paying for, either rent or whatever the occupation is. It's temporary. It could be shelter, it could be something, living with family. I think there's a transition period of 14 days. If they can't stay for more than 14 days, that's what's considered by HUD a transitional housing situation. So we don't see most of the homeless people sleeping on the street at night. But their situation is just equally as difficult in many situations as well, because I mean, if you're cohabitating with somebody, doubling up, as we talked about it, you're constantly feeling like you're impinging upon somebody. We had that in Ukraine. It was still due to much extent people in Poland who have taken in refugees. People living in other people's houses, crowding small places, makes for a very difficult environment. So, yeah, it's just what I was going to say is that most homelessness that you see as unsheltered homelessness in Europe is even more heavily male. It's almost entirely men that you'll see in that situation. And homelessness in America, particularly the unsheltered type, is majority men.
Well, panel, are there any other questions? Otherwise, we'll give Lauren an opportunity to make a concluding comment or two.
Could we applaud her?
Yeah, Lauren.
Thank you for coming on. It's not an easy job, bless you.
I think hearing you and seeing you and hearing you say the things you've said the way you've said them has given me more hope than I have had in a long time on this show, frankly.
Well, thank you so much. It's really nice to hear that. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and to share this information with folks.
And we will be replayed ad nauseum, and people can share this with your cohorts. they can find us on YouTube and watch you on this show.
Yeah.
Now, don't go and scare her like that, Ruth. But
that's all right. I knew what I was getting into.
I think it's important for our viewers to have heard this today, because I know that many of them are unaware of the extent of the situation of homelessness of our students.
Well,
so thanks.
You can count
thank you.
You can count me in that group until I saw the article about the Knights Keep. Lauren, again, we sincerely thank you for your time and your expertise. You obviously have an open welcome anytime that if something changes or you're concerned about something or whatever, you're welcome back.
Thank you so much.
So thanks again. And now you're also welcome to stay, because I know Fred O is desperately anxious to get into the latest politics.
Run, Lauren, run.
warning.
Or you can chicken out and hit the escape button. That's up to you. But
all right. Well, I think I will hop off, but I will be sure to watch and hear your comments, because I'm very interested to see how the rest of your conversation goes. But thank you all so much for this opportunity again. I hope you all enjoy the rest of your day.
Wishing you well in your work.
Thank you, Lauren. Well, now we have, I think, less than 10 minutes remaining in our, and I apologize for this nagging cough that I can't seem to get rid of, but I feel fine and it's not nasty anymore. It just won't go away. But sort of like me, Fred, right? I won't go away, right?
Say anything.
You know, I knew what you were thinking, though.
I'm sympathetic toward you.
I'm not going to go there, but
hitting is the word.
Just an entirely off our usual subjects. I read a thing. I've been following along because I don't understand it very well. The artificial intelligence stuff, and one of the things that I came across that I thought was—I mean, I never would have guessed it—is the computers that are used for artificial intelligence, and this would include the social sites and stuff, the Facebooks and so on and so forth that are used, uses an extraordinary amount of water to cool those computers. It's just mind-boggling big, to the extent that the average person today spends 2 hours and 23 minutes in social media and stuff, and it's predicted, now this was an article from the UK, from England, that by 2027, in the UK, half of all water use would be used to cool computers. Half. It's astonishing.
Related to that, I saw a thing that I was completely unaware of, and that had to do with Bitcoins. That because of the enormous amount of computer power and electricity needed for Bitcoin management, that they're called Bitcoin mines, and they are out in the middle of nowhere. And the one out in the west somewhere made so much noise from the exhaust fans that neighbors miles away were complaining about it. They couldn't sleep at night. I'm completely unaware of that. I mean,
would it be helpful if I explained what Bitcoin mining is for people?
Yeah,
we just do that some other time.
No.
Well, I mean, it's
go for it.
Okay, so Bitcoin and these other cryptocurrencies, basically, they use a kind of accounting or bookkeeping called blockchain. And if you are going to participate in the bookkeeping process with a computer to do this, to check that transactions are actually being done and everything is legitimate, this is what keeps these things secure, you can dedicate a computer to that. And in doing that, you actually are mining a Bitcoin for yourself in the future. Now, it's actually a logarithmic scale. So the first couple of Bitcoins that were ever mined did not take up nearly as much time as what the last ones are. And there is a cap on the actual supply of Bitcoin. This is the most popular of the cryptocurrencies. what they've done, because the value of these cryptocurrencies and mining them has gone up so much, people have dedicated computer farms for doing this. And that is what's generated. So the small guy doing it himself with his own computer running 24 hours is just not really contributing anything to that. So it's a huge amount of computer power that's taken, and it's about a lot of electricity going into it. And a lot of people have said, well, this isn't necessarily very sustainable. People have debated about it. I don't really know enough to say whether or not this is a good use of the energy or not. The water, the cooling, there are people that are finding locations that are much colder to operate these computer areas, and so they don't have to deal with that so much. The water is actually going to be recycled as well.
I believe that the largest Bitcoin mine farm is in Iceland.
That's what I believe too, yeah. I wasn't sure of that.
Well, don't blame me. I'm sticking with dollars. I don't understand this other stuff. But we can't, Fred, I don't know what I can do here. I can't not mention that we are on the cusp of some things here. Now, we're not going to, don't have time, so there's no point in getting into the weeds of getting into it. But we do have to just point out, we've had Super Tuesday this week, so the nomination process is largely over with now, if not entirely so. So we're going to have a rerun of 2020, and we'll have plenty of time to talk about it. In the meantime, Ambassador Haley has now officially suspended her campaign, and we are literally down to the two. The legal stuff with the former president, today we're taping on Thursday. Tonight is this annual State of the Union address, which the president, President Biden, is apparently kind of setting up to be the kickoff to his reelection campaign. So I'm sure we're going to hear a lot about things that have happened that he considers positive. One thing that has caught my attention, though, and now I might be violating my vow not to get into the details or whatever, but is it my imagination, or is Vice President Harris a lot more visible lately? She seems to have been meeting with overseas leaders and other things. It just seems to me, being the skeptical politician
she's going from not having been visible at all to just a handful of things. So I wouldn't say she's really out and about in the public, but yes, I've definitely seen her more involved with things.
All right. Well,
actually, what you're seeing is more coverage of her.
Sure. That's interesting.
Yeah, by both ends of the political spectrum.
Interesting point, John.
You know, when you talk to bridge the divide between the two topics, Fred, something that we've all got to watch out for is AI-generated misinformation. I think now there's a bit playing where President Biden trips or falls coming on or off of a plane. And as that happens, the camera cuts to Vice President Harris laughing. In fact, she were laughing at his mishap. We are in for an ugly, ugly campaign season. And one of the things that we all have to be keenly aware of is the misinformation that is everywhere and generated by people that we would be appalled if we knew who was generating it.
Ruth, this is one of those issues that you and I agree on 100%. Martha, go ahead.
Could we get an update on Ukraine, since it seems that things are going on over there?
That's exactly where I was heading at this moment. So, Tom, while we have you, could you give us an update on things specifically in Ukraine? And I hope we have an opportunity to talk just a moment at least about the latest in Gaza, where the ceasefire talks apparently have stalled.
Yeah, to me, the most interesting thing that's happening right now, insofar as the Russian invasion of Ukraine, is what's going on in Europe. And the discussion that's come about that was led by the French president, Emmanuel Macron, talking about we cannot rule out French boots, NATO boots, on the ground. He's not saying there is a plan for that, but he is saying we cannot rule that out. He has just recently I won't even say double down, because he's actually backed this up on several public opportunities, said that there, for France, there is no red line. There is nothing that they won't do. Now, of course, France has nukes, and nobody's talking about moving French nukes into Ukraine. I don't know if that's a red line, but that's definitely something that, you know, he's basically positioning himself as a voice in Western Europe that echoes what the Eastern Europeans, the Latvians, Lithuanians, Estonians, Romanians, et cetera, have been saying for 2 years, that, you know, you have to basically address Putin with force and with power and with no concern about pushing any red lines or something like that. Meantime, and John, I'll let you go to that, your comment and question. Have Chancellor Scholz in Germany, who is going around his home looking for a backbone at the moment. This is the way I put it, because he has constantly been denying capabilities that would be key to Ukraine from Germany's arsenal, which is pretty limited. And the Russians actually have been eavesdropping on their phone calls and found out that they were talking about whether or not these would be used to blow up the Kerch Bridge, which connects Russia to Crimea. So the whole story is getting very heated here, and the pressure on the German chancellor is actually getting quite hot. So we're seeing a response from Europe that I've been waiting for a year and a half, 2 years, something like that. And it's coming about very slowly, but it's coming about. And it's coming about largely because Ukraine has been losing ground. Now, Ukraine has not necessarily been losing a lot of material. They have been losing more material lately to stop the Russian advance. But the Russian losses are still way, way, way more numerous. The problem is, it's just the artillery is not there. Ukraine just does not have the artillery munitions. Now, one other quick thing, and John, I haven't forgotten you had something you wanted to say, is that Czechia, the Czech Republic, went out and sourced 800,000 units of artillery munitions in the last few weeks, and has asked everybody else in NATO in the world to help fund it, because they, you know, they're going to have to pay for this. And almost everybody's chipping in. Of course, at this stage, the one who is not chipping anything at all is the United States.
Now, we are under a minute, okay. So John, just you don't have much
literal
time.
Literally seconds before we started taping, I was informed that Bloomberg is reporting that Sweden, the newest NATO member, has opened the floodgates and is promising all its military might to munitions and et cetera to Ukraine.
And Denmark had done that a few weeks ago as well, so they're seeing a trend there.
Speaking of munitions, I've read that a large percentage, I can't give you the number, but it's a lot, of the munitions that Russia has gotten from North Korea have proven to be duds.
That's true, but there's also now more evidence that we might be seeing Chinese munitions being used by the Russians.
Hmm. Well, that's not good. We don't need escalation.
No. So, well, and we know who's palsy-wowsy with those men. It's really scary.
We are at the end of our allotted time, so we're going to have to sign off and say goodbye. Panel, thank you very much. I think our conversation with Lauren was particularly eye-opening, and it's something that we can't put in our rearview mirror, but need to keep an eye on. So
thank you for arranging that. That was very enlightening.
Thank you to Fred and Martha.
I'm glad to have done that. Martha gave me a kick in that same tush. And
Martha's our conscience.
Happily.
So, at that, we will sign off. So thank you, audience. We will see you next week. Goodbye now.
Thank you. Good night.
Enjoy, Scott.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.